I have a question for you. What happens when Jesus returns to this world? What happens to the Pope? Does the Pope step down? What happens to the church? Does Jesus now the head of the church here? Now, I tried to find an answer to this question on the internet, and I could not find any explanation. Nobody even touches this subject at all. Nobody even touches this subject at all. Amazing, right? It's amazing because Jesus is back, actually. And so it's quite interesting. A while ago, I excommunicated Pope Francis. I said, you know, it's time. And maybe this was just a precursor to recognize it's time that basically Jesus is now in charge of the church on this planet. He's back. It means the Pope is no longer the head of the church any longer. Interesting stuff, to say the least. So we're going to just get the ball rolling here. With these times and saying what needs to be said, Jesus has returned. Now, in A Course in Miracles, Jesus talks about what is the return of Christ. And he says, well, the return of Christ is the return to you, for you, the exchanging of the belief system of arrogance or the ego for the belief system of the Holy Spirit. And this returns Christ to your awareness. Okay, that's the return of Christ to all of us. Yes. But Jesus is very circumspect. In they didn't ask him, what about the return of Jesus Christ? They just said, what about the return of Christ? Now, Christ is a term which refers to the oneness of spirit, reality, the truth of reality, the pure love, pure freedom, pure spaciousness, our true nature, our true being. It refers to that. But Jesus, the Christ, refers to an aspect of spirit that had fully dropped all its arrogance entirely, okay, which is what we have to do as well. So Jesus didn't comment on what about the return of Jesus Christ. He said the return of Christ. So this is really quite interesting. And he's avoiding the question, basically. He's saying, don't worry about it. He's saying, look, you focus on the return of Christ and let me focus on, you know, I don't want to tell you. He says, well, I don't have any plans at the moment. When they asked him, are you coming back? Or what are your plans for the future? What are your plans? He says, I don't have any plans at the moment. Meaning he lives moment by moment by moment. But that does, you know, doesn't have any plans. It leaves the door open for it. He didn't say, no, I'm not returning. He could have easily said, no, I have no plans to return. I'm not returning. I just say, I'm not returning. But basically, he's saying, well, I'm perfectly free to return. I'm not telling you if I am, I'm going to return or not. So there's a certain amount of I don't know what the word is. I don't want to put a negative word on it because it's not negative. He's just saying, look, this is what you need to focus on. So he sort of dodges the question. So you might say, didn't give us the answer we were. Someone should ask, is Jesus Yeshua Christ? Are you going to return to this planet? It's plain and simple. Yeah, no one's asked him that from that I know, from anyone who's been in contact with him. But from what I have experienced, I say he's already back. This is what he made himself known in a dream that I had. Very clearly, I'm back. He said, I'm back here now. My attention is here. I'm here to relate. You know, it's very unambiguous. Okay, no ambiguity to it. Cut and dried, he's back. So the question is, what happens to the Pope now? Is the Pope really a Pope at this point? I say no. The Pope's no longer the Pope. It's Cardinal whatever. I don't even know if the Cardinals are the Cardinals now. Jesus is in charge of the church now. The entire church. He's the head of the church. He's in charge now. So it's a different dispensation. The church age has ended. Church age has ended. It's already ended. We're in a new dispensation already. And this is what I'm conveying to the world. Not that many are listening at this point, but of course Jesus only called a few apostles in the beginning, right? A few here, a few there, and weren't very many. So the news travels slowly at first, because people are saying, wait a minute, I'm not ready for this. What does this mean? But at least there's some that are ready for this and willing to convey what's going on, even though people will say, well, you're nuts. What are you talking about? Well, what are the people who are not aware of this talking about? Are they saying that unawareness is somehow right? You know, their attention was not able to focus on this, of what's going on. It's a play of attention. We have a play of attention that's going on, and I can see that people's attention is so badly fragmented. And even as I try to do this work that I'm doing, there's a lot of different forces that come in and try to distract me. Very much so. It's amazing. As soon as I make a move, the arrogance of the ego directs people to throw obstacles in my way and try to attract me, you know, away from this. It's very frustrating. It's very disconcerting that the people are that way, but they are, because they're under the spell of their own arrogance. Our arrogance casts a spell upon us. Spiritual arrogance casts a spell upon spirit, making the spirit believe that it's a body, that it's in a world, that it's in time, that it's in space, that it's bound by process and form. And this is a spell. This is an absolute delusional spell. So Jesus is back. Now, what does it mean? What? Nobody can answer. You know, does the Pope step down when Jesus returns? They don't address that. I don't know if the Catholic Encyclopedia addresses that. If anyone knows, I'd like to know what the actual. I'm sure they have that in their canonical law of saying, because certainly they expect Jesus to return. Well, what happens with the Church and the Pope at that time? Very simple question. I think that would be the first question that they would answer in their Church law as well. You know, let's start with the first question. When Jesus does return, you know, what happens to the Church? And then let's go backwards from there. But I don't see them, you know, emphasizing. I've never heard anyone talk of this question. But it's a question now we have to answer, because Jesus has returned. So these are questions that now need to be focused on. It's not a future event. The return of Jesus is not a future event. It's already happened. It's already happened. So we now need to start asking the questions, okay, well, how do we relate to what's already happened? This new dispensation has already taken place, and it's starting to flower now, starting to flower. I picked these roses a couple days ago, and they were just, you know, they had not opened up yet. They had not opened up yet, and let's see if I can get those in the picture, but... And now they're starting to open. This is like the new dispensation now of Jesus has returned here. Gradually, we start to become aware of it, and gradually it starts to open up for us. I'll swing this back here a little bit. So this is where we're at right now, and I'm doing the work I need to do here. Breaking the ice, that's what I do. I break the ice. I've always broken the ice in this world, which is, it's a tough thing to do. If you're an icebreaker, the ship, you know, you get boom, boom, you get, you know, you hit the ice and it shakes you up. But once the ice is broken, then it's easier for others to follow who may not have such stern, you know, shells or hulls of the ship. You know, they're not able to break the ice, but they are able to go forward once the ice has been broken. So when I excommunicated the Pope, maybe that was just a way of saying, hey, Pope, you know, it's over. It's finished. This is the last Pope anyway. A lot of people know that. I've been saying that. This is the last Pope. And what happens with the last Pope? Well, Jesus returns, the Pope resigns or steps down. Someone suggested that Pope Benedict resigned due to the apparition of Mary telling him he needed to step down. That has not been confirmed. Benedict did say he resigned because of a mystical experience that he had for like lasted 2 months, that God somehow spoke to him internally in his heart, telling him that he has to step down. Well, that it would be better to step down. And then Benedict would say, now that's a good thing, because now look what how great Francis is doing, you know, blah, blah, blah. Very nice collegiate things to say. But it might be very interesting if it was the apparition of Mary or somehow he stepped down on the Our Mother of Lourdes Day. If Mary said that, because Pope Francis, as I have said, is essentially turning the church over to the what you might call the Antichrist, which is the goddess, which is the belief in the infallibility of women, which is the new de facto world religion right now, which is the logic of arrogance trying to find a way to win. This is what it's come across right now, and it will change later, and it's always circularly going around and around, recycling all this nonsense over and over and over again. If you've been suffering from the logic of arrogance long enough, you start recognizing it's just shuffling these cards over and over and over, and then you start saying, hey, wait a minute, this deck is a bad deck, period. So this new Pope has been saying things that are just ruinous for the spirit of men, as far as undermining them. Men are desperately trying to maintain some sort of connection with spirit, and trying to avoid this newer religion, which is based on the belief in the infallibility of women and the guilt of men towards women and the need for men to expiate their guilt through basically being slaves to women and doing whatever they tell us to do. In other words, follow the authority, their infallible authority. It's a new infallible authority. Of course, the Pope has for a long time been seen as an infallible authority over the last couple thousand years, although quite a few people have recognized that they're not far from infallible, right? So the ego needs an infallible authority that is based on arrogance, and so the Pope is being replaced now with this radical feminist movement. These leaders will come into place. They'll be women, and they will be seen as the infallible authority. So, for the Virgin Mary to appear to Pope Benedict, if that is actually the case, he doesn't say it was, but this is a rumor. I don't know if it's true or not, but if it did happen, for instance, that would be very interesting, because basically she knew that her hand-picked man, Pope Francis, she needed to get him in there right now so that he could then turn the direction of the church towards goddess worship and the belief in the infallibility of women, which is what Francis is actually doing. Very interesting. I thought that when Pope Benedict resigned, I said, that's it. That something's very suspicious going on. He even talked about these wolves in the Vatican. He couldn't withstand them anymore. It was just terrible. Turning the church in the wrong direction. And some of the things that the Pope has been saying are just astonishing. Not all bad. Not everything, you know, it's not like someone does everything they say is hideous or terrible. No, he says some good things, too. Of course, but so did all the tyrants in history or whatever, you know, people who've pushed the world in the wrong direction. Many people love them and like them. They said a lot of things. They said, yeah, that's great. But overall, the most significant is the direction they're going in. And so that's what has to be looked at. And he just has just undermined men so badly by his statements. Calling men, you know, sexist and chauvinist if they criticize women over issues that are highly, highly volatile, where men have every right to speak how they feel, as if men have no right to express how they feel. That if they express how they feel towards the most obvious, most central relationship in their life, which is with women, that they're somehow sexist. You know, this is just shutting them up. This is turning them into slave status. It's unbelievable. Women can say anything they want to about men. Nobody says they're sexist. But if men say, hey, wait a minute, the declining birth rate, the declining marriage rate, they say, hey, we have a problem getting married and women don't want to marry us, blah, blah, blah. And the Pope says, well, that's sexist. You know, well, that is ridiculous. And claiming that quote unquote, Adam had no right to blame Eve for, you know, for the problems in the Garden of Eden, by Eve ate of the fruit and then gave it to Adam, and Adam ate of it and said, well, you know, I mean, she gave me the apple to eat, and we're related, we're one flesh, so I can't just be alienated and isolated for it. I need to share in the experiencing. So there's a give and take there. I mean, can't Adam criticize the situation and say, hey, this is the full context of the situation, instead of, you know, well, apparently not, according to the Pope. So these things are part of this new world religion that is taking place very, very fast, which is based on the egoic logic, which has come up with this so-called answer of how to win. And this is the doctrine of the infallibility of women. So anything that anybody says that critiques or simply notices what women are up to, if it's not some sort of praise and worship of the woman, it's automatically said it's a war against women. You know, this is how they're trying to shut all criticism up to bring about this goddess-worshipping infallibility of women, new world religion. This is what it's based on. And, of course, from there, it'll be very easy for extraterrestrials who have been subverting this planet for quite some time now to take over the behind-the-scenes bureaucracy of the whole planet. Very easy. Much more difficult if they're trying to deal with men. They don't like dealing with men. See, this is the key to what's going on this planet. Extraterrestrials don't trust men of this planet. They don't like dealing with them at all. You know, because men are saying, hey, wait a minute, you know. Who are you to tell? Maybe I don't want you here. Who are you to tell me? In other words, some backbone there. You know, they're not so easy to deceive because men have been in positions of leadership in this planet for so long. They've seen it all. They're not so easily flattered. Okay, they're not so easily flattered. They're pragmatists. They're realists. They're saying, you know, hey, you know, show me the, you know, you want to do business and let's find out what you're really about. Whereas women wanting, lusting after these positions of leadership so badly, easy to flatter them. Say, oh my gosh, you should have been doing this all along. You know, it's a crime that you haven't been in charge of this plan. Unbelievable. Well, we're so happy you're here now. You're going to do so much better job than the men, and just all this flattery. And they say, by the way, we're here to help you out and make sure that the men never oppress you ever again. And we have these steps that we advise you that you can take to make sure that that doesn't happen. And you get to retain your rightful, you know, leadership and conservatorship and mothership of this planet. You're actually the mothers of this planet. You know, it's all this new age BS, which is flattery. It's flattering them. And they fall for it hook, line, and sinker, whereas a man would just say, wait a minute, you know. Who are you trying to kid here? Let's see what your cards really are here. What are you really after? I don't care. You know, you can't flatter me. Leadership is a pain, you know, anyway. So, big deal. You know, we're used to it. And we're used to being deceit and treachery and all the double dealing and all the stuff that comes with trying to leadership of this place. And so, why should we think that you're any different than that? Let's find out what you're really about. That kind of thing. You know, it's hard questions, tough questions, tough dealing, and we might say, no, you know what, we don't really need you. I think that you're here to deceive us. So the ETs hate that. They hate it. They hate men. I'm telling you that. I've had some dealings with them, and they have a very thin skin. They hate disrespect, what they call opposition, or not opposition, but simply, hey, transparency. They hate transparency. They hate it. They want to do it secretive. And so they're looking for someone to flatter who will not demand transparency of them. And they found what they were looking for, which is Eve, basically, here. And that's the same old story over and over and over again. And then once Eve gets in that position, what the heck is Adam supposed to do? And maybe leave the planet, actually. So Jesus has returned, and he's in charge of the body of the church. All repentant believers constitute the body of Christ. Now, it doesn't matter what religion you're in, actually, because the body of Christ refers to a spiritual body where name and form don't matter, okay, because we're spirit. We're not a body. So all the names and forms that we have on this planet, the bodies have, don't matter in terms of the oneness of Christ. It doesn't matter in terms of the oneness of Christ. Okay, Jesus is part, also the oneness of Christ. All of us are the oneness of Christ, the oneness of the sonship of God, the oneness of the Spirit. So there's a lot of maturity that needs to take place on this planet from our experiencing here and shedding. And it's very difficult because you're not sure what to set down and what not to set down. And it is a struggle, to say the least. And so I fully understand the struggle that everyone has in listening to these videos, having been through it all myself, and the uncertainty, you know, just saying, wow, I just can't put it all together. You know, I can't put it all together. It is quite difficult, because we're still so stuck in our arrogance and so afraid of the continuity fear of letting it go. We're so afraid that we're very hesitant to set anything down that we're used to holding on to. We say, well, at least I'm still alive, even though I've been holding on to this, not realizing it's we're not really experiencing life here at all. There's no life in the kind of type of experiencing we're having on this planet. That's not life at all. It's arrogance. It's a denial of life, actually, of what we've been experiencing. It's a denial of life. So what I keep doing is I keep pushing the envelope here as fast as possible. And I just realized it's time to talk about this. The removal of the Pope is finished with the Pope. It's the last Pope, and this papacy is now over. The fact that Jesus has returned means his papacy is over. So he no longer speaks as the Pope to the faithful of this world. We need to start turning our attention to the fact that Jesus is here, and we can relate to Jesus directly. We can have a direct relationship with Jesus. That is absolutely true. We don't need any intermediary for that relationship. And Jesus told me, I'm here to relate. Who wants to relate with me? I'm here now to relate. It's on. So I said, okay, let's do it. Absolutely, let's do it. So the attention again is on your relationship with truth, your relationship with Jesus. And Jesus is his functional attribute is the teacher of truth. So our attention in relating with him, our attention would be on the truth, on truth. We need to focus on the truth of our being, which is not based on any winning or any losing whatsoever. It's inherently perfectly stable and unchallenged in any way. There is no challenge to our being whatsoever. We ourselves cannot challenge our own being. We can arrogantly think we can, but we cannot. Our being, it cannot be challenged in any way. It cannot be tested or tried or tricked or deceived or nothing or contaminated or broken or anything. None of that can happen to our being. So at this point, the church age has ended, is what I'm saying. The church age ends when Jesus returns. Jesus has already returned. The church age is officially over. It's over. And the sooner we realize this, the better off we'll be. Because now it's time to turn our attention to truth, consciousness, and get it. You know, it's time to step in. It's time to not step into it. It's time to give up any notion that stepping into it is necessary, because we're already in it. We cannot separate from truth consciousness. It's impossible. But we've been imagining that we've been stepping towards it. But the belief that we're stepping towards it is the illusion, is the hallucination, is the self-delusion, because that means that we're separate from it in some way. And separation is an illusion. So you cannot step towards truth. You're already in it. So in your imagining, you know, let go of your stepping thoughts, your arriving thoughts, your attaining thoughts. Those are the thoughts that deceive you. Even though we speak of being on the path, etc., it's really the path of no path that we've been on. Okay, it's really the path of no path, which is setting down the idea of arriving, of stepping, of attaining at all. That's what prevents us from realizing where we are, because we're waiting for the attainment to happen as if it's something yet to happen. See, this is how we deceive ourselves. Now, why am I doing this job here? As I've said before many times, in a previous life, I built up somehow I built up enough confidence where I was willing to speak out in public. I was a very well-known public figure, and I was able to speak up about culture and beliefs and ideology and culture, and basically admonish countries about that they're going in the wrong direction, that the culture is going downhill. I was sort of in a minority, really, but I was opposing what we call this modernistic culture that we now realize is such a terrible thing. I was opposed to idolatry. I was opposed to a lot of stuff, and I spoke up and said, no, this is wrong. This is bad. Don't follow this. And so I was willing to speak up. Speak up. I was absolutely willing to. And I did speak up. And so I'm used to doing that. I'm used to it. I don't shy away from it. And there's a lot to speak up about right now in this world. That is for sure. Ultimately, I was proved to be very, very correct, because the ultimate outcome of what I vehemently rejected and warned people about, spoke out, ultimately it led to World War II. Ultimately, it led to World War II. Absolutely, it did. And I was very, very, very upset when I returned to this world and heard about the full what happened in World War II. I was just crushed by it, because I really, tried my best to warn the world that this is the direction you're going in is going to be disastrous, and the world went that way anyway. So my words, warnings were in vain, so to speak, and I was just disconsolate about what happened in World War II. Really, it was the result of following a pagan, idolatrous, body worshipping, arrogant path, Especially on the on the part of Germany, for sure, and unfortunately, it had a very, very bad result. So I'm here again saying, the path that the world is following is a very bad path, very arrogant. It's the path of arrogance, and the path of arrogance is always a terrible path. And there's not enough repentance in the world. So we need to connect with Jesus as soon as possible, so we can be empowered, spiritually empowered, and we're not going to be shut up by culture and the world, our determination is not going to be crushed by the arrogance that's at play in the world. Don't put your faith in any election. This presidential election comes up as a sham. It's been a sham for quite some time. Don't put your faith in Jesus, or put your faith in truth consciousness. Okay, don't put your faith in politicians. They're the lowest of the low in many ways. Thinking that those are most expert manipulating, their arrogance has figured out ways to manipulate people and get votes and get rich, etc. Don't put your faith in politicians. Put your faith in truth consciousness. Put your faith in truth consciousness. Put your faith in truth consciousness. The symbol of truth consciousness has returned to this planet. We call Jesus the Christ. And a lot of people take their soul cues on Jesus from the Bible. And there's a lot of verbiage, as I have said, in the Bible, which raises eyebrows. New Testament, even the New Testament, though of course the Old Testament is, I don't even want to talk about that. Let's talk about the New Testament. And there's still some verbiage in there that raises eyebrows. But if we look at the new dispensation of Jesus, in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, and what Jesus has been putting out the last 40 years, 40 plus years, 45 years, let's say last 50 years, rounded up, there's no raised eyebrows at the verbiage there. It's just straight right on pure truth. So we have to believe that either the Gospels were written by those who were put their own interpretation on what Jesus said, and or included various teachings which were tried to make nice with Rome. okay, or tried to make nice with the Jewish tradition, or tried to keep a sense of continuity with what came before, you know, who knows exactly, or Jesus actually spoke those terms, words, because of the continuity fears everyone had, he needed to bend over backwards to try not to frighten them too much. You know, those are all possibilities, but we know from now, the recent evidence is that Jesus doesn't raise any eyebrows with what he says. It is absolute pure truth. Now, I haven't heard anything from Rome or the Catholic or Christian authorities, really, about A Course in Miracles. You know, it's pretty strange that they would be the shepherds of Christians and not be aware that Jesus is directly communicating with us now. Very odd. Maybe they're afraid they'll lose their flock. You know, the flock will start paying more attention to what Jesus says and what they're saying. Maybe that's the trouble. And maybe they enjoy their, you know, the perks of I don't know. I mean, some Christians have gone towards it, absolutely. And some have denounced it, too. And just rejected it. So, just like when Jesus came to the Jews, they rejected him. Well, now in his new dispensation coming here, a lot of Christians are rejecting Jesus, actually, which isn't a surprise at all. Our continuity fear and our arrogance, spiritual arrogance, is so deeply rooted in habit within us that it is exceedingly difficult to set it aside. So those who are on the path of no path must be patient, they must be diligent, they must persevere, they must support one another in love, they must give honest admonishment and critique, not in a mean-spirited way, but in a positive-spirited way, and one must have the humility of heart to listen to what is said. This is all part of the whole situation, is humility, and willing to have an open mind about that, hey, I need to continue, and I'm still suffering from a lot of, you know, arrogance-based and continuity fear. Okay, someone is trying to reach me now on the phone for some reason, probably to interfere with what I'm doing here. I don't know. No? Okay. That's all right. Okay, everything's fine. Positive message. Positive message. Okay, so I'm just thanking me. Thanking me. Oh, man. So, it's frustrating to... I said to Jesus, when you come back, nobody's going to pay attention. I guarantee you. Nobody. Well, we'll see. I have to amend that at some point. Maybe at first, nobody will pay attention. I can understand. I mean, I can understand it, absolutely understand it. You know, it's not like this is a mystery to me. Having worked through it, it was so difficult for me to work through all this arrogance, and I continue the difficult work. And it is no picnic. And if there's any thought in our minds that maybe we don't have to do this, we will certainly avoid doing it. Try to avoid doing it. There's no question. That's why distraction is such a wickedness, because we're too desperate. We're looking for any excuse to not have to do this. And so we'll clutch at straws. We'll clutch at straws. But but one of the things that helped me out the most is I realized that I've lived before, that when you die, that's not the end of your involvement with this world at all. Your belief system remains. Your belief system is a spiritual, mental belief system. The body does not produce that belief system. So when the body dies, you maintain your belief system. And that brings you right back to another body. And so I realized, if I don't succeed, I'm going to come back to this world again. And seeing how this world is going, I don't want any part of the future here. Absolutely not. And so it terrifies me. So, you know, I'm so scared of it that I can't stop working. I can't stop working on this. It's a disaster to come back in this world. A spiritual disaster. And I would not fit in the slightest bit in such a place. So, but I know if I'm not liberated from arrogance, I will come back for sure. For sure. So this really lit a fire under me. When I realized that my previous lives, it was like, I think it was about 32 or 33 of them. There's so many, I think, on this planet. It could have been other places too. I'm not absolutely sure about that. But then I said, oh my gosh, you know. And I thought I wasn't coming back last time because I thought I accomplished so much and tried to raise culture up that I thought this is sufficient enough to save me. No, it isn't. It has nothing to do with it. And so I came back here again. And this time I came back to help out Jesus because Jesus, I'm sure, told me that by trying to help me out, you're going to help yourself out. By focusing on this, you're going to have to apply yourself as much as you possibly can to your own enlightenment, you know, your own liberation from arrogance. So it's a win-win situation. I don't think I do very well in a robotic artificial intelligence. Women are infallible, goddess worshiping world. I don't think I do very well there at all. I think I'd get depressed and commit suicide if I was in, you know, in such a place. I think it would be hideous. There's no way. Cannot do that. It's, you know, just again, the play of sheer arrogance in this world is too much. It's too much. So the awareness of reincarnation really has saved me, where most people think that if they die, that's it. And I realize that's absolutely not true. That our beliefs that we're following don't come from our brain. Okay, the brain is like a computer, but the software programming doesn't come from the computer. Even though we have the brain trying to do some programming itself, etc. But the real programming doesn't come from the brain at all. Our arrogance comes from spirit. Our arrogance and the logic of arrogance comes from our spirit, which is formless essence. And so when the body wears out and the blood stops circulating, which just means there's no more energy being given to the brain, you know, the computer shuts down. The life of the spirit continues, and the belief system that the spirit has that it's following continues. Absolutely continues. And the logic of arrogance continues. And the logic of arrogance will always bring you back into the play of bodies here. Because it has to have a winner and a loser. And how can anything but a body lose? You know, only bodies can lose. Formlessness, how can formlessness lose? Cannot. So you will come back as a body again as long as arrogance is the belief system of arrogance is in control and you haven't set it down. You'll come back to the world again and engage in this symbolic play of bodies of winning and losing based on this imaginary contest we think we're having with God to determine who is really perfect and who isn't really perfect so we can usurp the place of God as prime creator. This is what it's all based on. Now Jesus talks about the end times, there'll be divisions within the families, where basically when Jesus comes back, and he's already here, we're going to have to decide who are we going to follow. Are we going to follow Jesus, or are we going to follow the church? Are we going to follow the state? Are we going to follow whatever, you know? Who is the good shepherd? And some people might say, no, I'm going to continue to follow the Pope and the church, or you know, various whatever. And others will say, no, I'm going to follow Jesus. And follow, I mean, listen to the advice and walk beside him. I'm going to walk beside Jesus as he gives the right good advice and offers us right offers and helps us out. This is what's going to happen now. So, yeah, there'll be divisions among spouses, among, you know, relatives, among friends. All of that is going to happen now. It's hard to say which way, you know, various people will go, hopefully, you know, many as possible, accept the invitation of the Spirit of Truth here. Okay, so the path of no path is what we've been on. Again, all thoughts of attaining, arriving, stepping, leaping into, reaching, finalizing, all those thoughts, drop them all. Though that's what constitutes our delusion that we're not already where we already are, that we're not already dwelling in reality, dwelling in the pure land. We're already dwelling in the pure land of reality, of freedom, of perfection, of perfect love. There's nowhere else to be. There's nowhere else to be. We're just believing that it's something that to be attained, because we're engaged in this contest, saying that the winner of this contest then gets perfection. But first, we have to have a winner. And of course, in order to have a winner, you have to have a loser. So somehow we have to make it seem like God is lost the contest too. You know, it's not enough to say we won. We have to have evidence that God lost. So we split our arrogance into winners and losers, of good arrogance, bad arrogance, and play this crazy game that we've been involved with here. So I haven't had any more dreams, but that's because I needed to get this information out, and Jesus is probably waiting to see, okay, did you, because I did relate with Jesus. We went back and forth, and something was conveyed there. I couldn't remember exactly what it was, but maybe he was saying, hey, you know, can you say this? Can you stand up and say this? And I always in my life, I always felt I needed to say something that people could hardly believe me saying it, and that I always felt that, like, Spirit was kind of skeptical, thinking like, I doubt you're going to be able to say that, you know, like, there's a lot of doubt that I would really say it. And I always said, no, you put me to the test. I always say to Jesus, put me to the test. We'll see if I'll speak up or not. You know, I think, because I feel like there's some sort of skepticism that, you know, and so I said, I believe I will. I believe I'll be able to speak up. So I am speaking up. Right, what else can I say? What else can I say? I've said enough. You know, this is plenty to say. You know, this spills the beans on the whole situation. And it required an enormous effort on my part to get the nerve to speak up like this. So I've always been suffering from terrible nerves in this world. Terrible nerves, because I always wondered, would I be able to speak up in this world? I came into this world very confident, and my confidence got knocked out of me by the world. The world was vicious towards me, because I came here to say what I'm saying now, and have been warning people, and the world, the arrogance of the world, was just absolutely furious with me. So I lost my confidence, and then from that point, I was very frightened that I wouldn't be willing to speak up when the time came. I'd freeze up and wouldn't say anything, which means coming in this world is just a complete waste of time for me. I did, you know, what a waste of time to come into the world then, if I fail, you know, my mission here. So I was very afraid I'd freeze up. So I had to work constantly to try and free my nerves up so I wouldn't freeze up, so my voice wouldn't disappear, so I wouldn't get sick. So, you know, I've been battling through all this sickness and trouble. This is just fear, you know, battling through all this fear. Like, how dare you say stuff like this? Who are you to say stuff like this? This is what arrogance says. You know, arrogance says, wants to tell you that it appoints the one who speaks up. And, of course, the one that it appoints is one of arrogance, that will say what arrogance wants it to say. So arrogance says, how dare you, you know, free yourself of arrogance? That's totally arrogant to free yourself of arrogance. And, of course, that's nonsense. That's complete insane thinking, because that's a trap. If it's arrogant to free yourself of arrogance, then how can you free yourself of arrogance? It's impossible. It's impossible. Because even if you do free yourself, you're being arrogant. And if you don't free yourself, you're still arrogant. So it's an impossible trap that arrogance demands of us. So I always said to Jesus, I'll do it, put me to the test, I'll do it. So it's good to be able to do it, you know, finally. and say the things, and not many people are listening now. I understand that entirely, because they're like, whoa, you know, I don't know if I'm ready for this yet. So they're waiting to see how it plays out. Am I going to be okay? You know, is this true? All this kind of stuff. So that's understandable. You know, it's totally understandable. Not bothered by it. I got a job to do, and I have to do it. The job that I came to do. And so far, I haven't heard from all those in the world claiming to be Jesus. No one, haven't heard from them yet. Because obviously, when the real Jesus comes, you know, now that he's here, it's going to become apparent that they're not, you know, the real Jesus. But that's okay, too. I understand, you know, they were just trying to win. This is what arrogance does. We're trying to win. We're trying to win the contest, the imaginary contest with God. And we think if we don't do that, we're going to be annihilated. So, you know, it's forgiven. It's all forgiven. Forgiveness is the name of the game here. Forgive yourself. Forgive yourself. Forgive yourself for everything you've tried to do. You've just been trying to win. That's all. You don't need to win. You don't need to win. There's no contest. So give up all thoughts of winning. Give up all thoughts of losing. Give up all thoughts of attaining, of arriving, of achieving, of recognizing, of stepping into it, leaping into it. Give up all thoughts of attainment. Give up all thoughts of attainment and non-attainment. Give up all thoughts of attainment and all thoughts of non-attainment. As Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. And I say, don't chase after them. You know, you can let them go and say, whoa, where are you going? Wait a minute. Don't chase after them. Just keep sitting quietly. Keep sitting quietly. Now, you know, they talk about social justice in the world and poor and all this stuff like that. And okay, that's one issue. But this enlightenment is a different issue actually altogether. It's setting down our arrogance that believes that we're even a body, that believes that we're not free, that believes that we can be oppressed, that believes that we can be victimized, that believes all this is arrogance, pure arrogance. The belief that we can be stupid, that's pure arrogance. Stupidity is just pure arrogance. Absolutely it is. We're all perfect. So give up all ideas of becoming perfect. All the ideas of attaining and non-attaining, becoming and non-becoming. Just let all that go. And realize that you're already that. I am already that. I already know that already I am. So social justice, all this kind of things, poverty. Well, we had in church today, some lady gave a talk about the Catholic charities and how they help out. That in Silicon Valley, it's like 38,000 children in poverty, living in poverty or something. And they highlighted one. It's pretty interesting how they did it. Politically correct by not bringing up, you know, the ethnicity. Well, the ethnicity was a white ethnicity, not bringing up the likelihood that most of those living in poverty are here, you know, having crossed the border, etc., you know, possible. And it's okay, it's fine. It's all is good. And so, you know, I said, hey, okay, let's give some money. Why not? There's nothing wrong with helping people. If that's what you want to do in that way, that's fine. So, you know, it's not like, you know, you have to stop being quote unquote compassionate by the standard of the world, you know. And an amazing thing happened in church. After communion, we went back to our seats, and then we noticed that the people behind us had left. And suddenly there's somebody like starts talking out loud and with vicious words and swear words and cursing. Yeah. And it was cursing women, you know. He's like, it's, and it was this guy in a black hoodie. I mean, this was some derelict, homeless, horrible, down on his luck person, a drug addict. I mean, this guy was scary. I don't know. I've never seen such a scary person before. And he was cursing, you know, cursing people out loud and stuff. And you know, it's like, wow. Eating food in church, and I mean, this guy looked like he was some demon from hell. I mean, he looked so bad. But you know, I said, okay, you know, okay, what do you do? What do you do? He's sitting right behind me, right behind me. And you know, I just said, you know what? That's okay. And there's something that always is very interesting in life, that stuff has happened to me that I wasn't sure how to take it. And this time I've started to see, okay, you know what? I'm put different places and I'm just like there. And the stuff that happens around me, I say, what is going on? Why? And I've sort of found out that there's something about when you have to have some truth consciousness in you, that there's a presence to that truth consciousness. And others, just by being in proximity to the truth consciousness, they absorb that. They absorb it somehow. It affects them. It affects them in a positive way. And so I just said, hey, you know, in all of the church, why did this guy have to come sit right behind me? And I said, well, maybe he is just, it's helping him spiritually because of my capacity to put the whole situation into context. Obviously, he was extremely aggrieved with women. He was extremely aggrieved and dangerously aggrieved, I would say. Whereas I have, you know, a full picture of the situation and a forgiving picture and not in a mean-spirited way. I just say this is the logic of arrogance, that those under the spell of it are simply trying to win, and this is how they're trying to win now. And I'm just pointing it out. And you need to, you know, all is forgiven. We need to repent and set down, take the path of no path, you know, use the tools of repentance. So I don't have, you know, I'm not hostile, you know, to women or anything like that. Of course, all women are unique. Each one has their own spectrum of where they're at in terms of repentance or non-repentance, etc. You know, it's just like same with men. So I just say, wow, this guy really needs help. Somehow he has his extreme grievances towards women. He was swearing at them in church out loud, you know, and under his breath too. He was boiling with this intense anger and hostility in his whole face, the way he looked. I'm telling you, you could not paint a picture that looked as frightening as this person looked. It was astonishing, just really astonishing. And so, but I wasn't afraid or nervous, and nobody in the church reacted to it. So I said, maybe the Holy Spirit sent him there just so he could hang out real close to me, and he might get a feeling of forgiveness from this. He needs to forgive himself. He needs to realize he doesn't have to be in this fury. You know, there's a way to repent and get free of it. I mean, if you felt you couldn't get free of what's happening in the world, then I could understand the fury. Absolutely. Nobody wants to be enslaved. But if you realize you can get free of it through repentance, then, you know, you laugh at it. All is good. You don't have this intense, ferocious, frustrating hostility, which is certainly building up in the world now. So maybe this helped him. So I didn't have any negative feeling towards him or judgmental feeling or anything. I wasn't afraid. I just said, okay, let him sit here. That's fine. Let him sit here. No big deal. Maybe it'll help him. Needs to recognize there is a way out of arrogance. Because the way that arrogance is playing right now is really bad for a lot of men, to say the least. It will be very bad. And if they don't have the tools of repentance to get free of arrogance, then they're going to feel very, very cornered and trapped. No question about it. And they're probably going to be dealt with very severely by the authorities, the gendarmes, I mean, the way that the New World Order and New World Religion and New World Bureaucracy has plans for all those who have trouble coping with their slave status. And of course, so all that's planned out. And so maybe I just pray that it helps this spirit and brother spirit. We're all one in spirit. The Holy Spirit loves all of us equally. There's no preference. God loves all of us equally. So God loves that suffering man right there, just the same as He loves Jesus. There's no difference whatsoever. So pragmatically, I see in the state of pragmatism right now, there's a temporary difference. But ultimately and absolutely, the absolute truth, there is no difference whatsoever. In terms of God's love, there's no difference. He's just having a hard time seeing it right now. And good Lord, he looked like a wraith. Or I can't even describe how he looked. I cannot. It's hard to look at him because I said, what is that? You know, what is that? Occasionally we get some very odd interruptions there. It's very scary sometimes. Of course, the priest never stops. Never acknowledges anything that's taking place. Never stops. You know, it's funny. Have you had people drop, lose consciousness, faint, and collapse, and stuff, and never stops. Never even blinks an eye. All sorts of stuff. Never blinks an eye. Just keeps on going. So, the situations that arise I have now, I realize that sometimes there's people that are really down on their life and their luck. I can tell, like I was on the sidewalk and this man was walking towards me. And the person I was talking with like basically fled. He said, okay, I got to go. Let's see, this guy's coming, I got to go. And I said, okay, I need to go too. But at least the guy walked right past me. And I could tell, he was muttering and talking. I looked down and I could see exactly, you know, the pain that he was suffering and the trouble. I said, wow, that could be me. It could be anyone. You know, this is this. And so I just felt like, hey, you know what? I'm not judging you at all. I'm not judging you at all. You know, God loves you the same as God loves me. There's no condemnation in Christ and God towards you whatsoever. And you can get well. You absolutely can recover from this and free yourself from all affliction and all trouble. And in fact, I know you absolutely will. There's no question about it in my mind. So I felt like he was meant to be walking past me at that time just to feel the vibe, you know, to feel the vibe, to get this reassurance. You know, maybe he's feeling, you know what, I want to get better. I want to try to get better. I want to free myself. But is there anybody even in the world that believes I can? And then just feeling that I don't even have to say anything. Just feel the vibe. He somehow his spirit picks up on that and says, oh, yeah, there's somebody here that is absolutely certain that I can get well and free myself from bondage to the slavery of arrogance, which is all slavery is slavery to arrogance, actually, our own arrogance. So it's not like you're necessarily going to be surrounded by all the pretty people. You know, if the more truth conscious you have, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to attract all these, you know, beautiful people, pretty people. You might attract those who are desperate. I believe Jesus said, I didn't come here for the righteous, I came here for sinners. The desperate. Jesus being truth consciousness. And Jesus said to us, hey, the disciple is not greater than the teacher, but the disciple can perfect their learning and be just like the teacher. Okay, and that's what Jesus calls us to be. So Jesus calls us to be like him, which is truth consciousness. And truth consciousness in this world may attract those who are desperate. And Anandamayi Ma gave a great teaching about this, where there was some maniac came to her ashram when she was there holding silent satsang, and her handlers there who felt that they were needed to be in charge of what was going on, and they helped facilitate everything. You know, this is kind of like Jesus had actually a group of women disciples who followed the apostles around, and ministered to, you know, their needs, I guess, food and some sewing, whatever. I mean, they took care of a lot of stuff, actually. Jesus had a following of women that followed him around and did a great deal of good work and helped support the whole situation, actually. So Nanamama had this group of women that followed her around and took care of a lot of stuff, because she had no identification with the body whatsoever and didn't even eat. She had to be prompted to eat, could not feed herself. She lifted no hands, no effort to feed herself whatsoever. They had to literally, you know, feed her. And she paid no attention to the body, you know, clothing herself, feeding herself, nothing. She was oblivious to the body, basically. And so this maniac was acting out and screaming, clearly crazy, you know, and cursing her, and I think, and they prevented him from coming in, to see her. And she was sitting there in silence, and suddenly she said, "Hey." When they came back in, I guess they told him to go away. She said, "Did you just send somebody away?" And they said, "Oh, yeah. There's this guy hates you, is cursing you, and all this terrible lunatic guy's dangerous." And she said, "I told you, everyone is welcome to come see me. Don't stop. Anyone who wants to come see me, don't stand in their way." So she admonished them very severely, these women who were in charge of this. And they said, "Oh, my gosh." She said, "Go get him and bring him back." So they had to go get him, say, "Oh, you know, it's okay, you can come in." And he came in cursing and everything like this, and then he gradually became quiet, and then he sat there. And just the spirit of truth was so strong there that it convinced this man that he can get well, that he doesn't need this affliction. This affliction is only the work, the logic of arrogance playing out as it plays out like a great river with all these eddies and side streams and things, you know, the little pools here. And there's so much complexity that the logic of arrogance just constantly in its creativity, our creativity just keeps generating so many, many, many different conditions, you know, and situations, all of which are illusion. And he became convinced that he could get well, because I said, "Oh my gosh, you know, the spirit of truth is in this world. I'm experiencing it, and I know that I too am the spirit of truth, and it's within me, and I can get well from this." And then he changed just like that. Many, 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 many people changed in the presence of Ananda Mahima, as they did in the presence of Jesus and the presence of other saints. They realized that they can get well. But before, they were desperate. They said, I don't think I can. Nobody can. I don't see anybody getting well. You know, it's only arrogance here. There's only arrogance. So therefore, I have to follow the logic of arrogance. Therefore, I'm trapped in this situation that the logic of arrogance has led me to. I'm trapped in it. But then they experience the spirit of truth. And they say, "Wow, wait a minute. They're not trapped at all. In fact, they're completely free of arrogance. So I know I can get better. I know it. I know it. I know it. I know it. When I came across A Course in Miracles, I knew I was going to get better. I knew it. I was absolutely certain about it." He said, "This is the proof that there is an explanation for it. There is a way to view it. There is a way to get free of it. Absolutely. We can shed light on it. It doesn't have to be a mystery. We can bring it to light and get free of it." And I was absolutely convinced of it. So the spirit of truth is very helpful in this world, even if you don't say a thing, even if you just pass somebody on the street. So I've sort of become aware that the people that like get close to me, I've always had like people get close, but they don't say anything. They don't want to interact. They pretend that they don't even know I'm there because they're afraid, you know, they're afraid to acknowledge anything. And I just like, what's going on? You know, what's going on? But it is a little frightening when you get someone like that who is clearly very disturbed, maybe even violently disturbed, through feelings that they're trapped, so badly trapped, and the world's against them. And certainly, during this time, a lot of men can be feeling that right now. They are really have been put into an incredibly vicious trap by the logic of arrogance, where they're supposed to play this role of, you know, being lower than dogs. I mean, this guy was lower than a dog. You know, you look at him, you think a dog was what had greater intelligence than this guy, had some greater spirit than this guy. He was like lower than an animal. You know, really, that's the only way I can explain it. But I'm absolutely sure he can be free of that. Absolutely sure of it. Not any doubt in my mind that he will get free of that, and he will be a saint someday for sure. As we all will be. He will dwell in the spirit of truth someday. Absolutely. He will abide in the bliss of oneness, of original natural being one day. Absolutely he will. Hopefully soon. No question about it. We can never remain enslaved by arrogance forever. It's impossible. There's nowhere else to go from arrogance except to realize that we never left reality. Never left reality at all. So there's nowhere to go. We just have to realize there's nowhere to go. No coming, no going, no arriving, you know. None of that. Drop all those thoughts. And this is the weird thing, is that these weird people tend to drift, come into church in the middle of Mass or something, they're homeless, whatever, and they always seem to sit either in front of me or behind me. It's the weirdest thing. Or close to me. You know, they've got the whole doggone church. They can sit anywhere, and I keep thinking, why in the heck are they sitting near me? And this again, the guy's right behind me, and people left after the communion, so there was this open spot behind me. He comes in and sits right behind me. It's a big church. I mean, the odds of that happening are impossible. And it's not like I'm on the back row or anything like that. No, they actually have to walk up and go and end up sitting right behind me or right in front of me. It's like, uh-oh, not again. Why? Why me? What is this? And so I just have to believe that, you know, that Holy Spirit is sent up for a purpose. That they're desperate. There's a lot of minds in this world who are quite desperate, actually. And I try to follow the advice of Jesus. Don't ever reject someone or send them away. He healed the lepers. You know, I came for sinners. I don't know. And Ananda Maima, same advice is, you never send anyone away who came to see her. He said, it's all the grace of God. Just let the grace of God work. They've come for a reason, because they're ready. They're ready to recognize that they're not bound by this. Their conditions. They're not bound. They're free. Now, so a saint like the Spirit of Truth can walk down a street and not say anything to anybody, and people will be tremendously blessed by that, even though they don't even realize what happened. They'll have some sort of inner assurance, like the feeling, you know what? I just feel like I can, I'm not stuck like I thought I was. I thought I was stuck with all these afflictions, mental afflictions that I have. And now I feel like, you know what? I feel I can get free of them. It's just a sort of inner knowing. I just feel confident that somehow I can get free of this, and I'm going to do it. This is what the saints help out with in this world, is that inner assurance. There's some inner assurance that they feel like it's been done before. It can be done again. I know it's possible, and I'm going to do it. Now, of course, the ego will twist all this and throw some plausible denial about all this, as it always does. What else can it do? It has to deny truth. It has to deny that truth is true. It will say, well, maybe this is true, but we can't determine if it's true or not yet, because we haven't won the contest. Truth is something yet to be determined, is the ego's viewpoint. And this is, again, you know, totally false. And this is what the world's in the grip of. This is why it's so difficult to come into this world and maintain truth consciousness here. Because when you start speaking from the standpoint of truth consciousness, people say, you're crazy. You know, what you're saying is fundamentally is nice, but truth hasn't been decided yet. We don't have a winner yet. We don't have a winner. So you cannot arrogantly assert that you're a winner. They think that because you have truth consciousness, you think that you've already won the contest with God. And they don't realize that there is no contest with God, and therefore truth consciousness is here right now. It's always here. There is not something to be attained later. It is not something to be attained later. But it's very difficult in this world to keep truth consciousness because of this attitude of the arrogance of the world that truth consciousness is yeah, it's valid, but it's something that has to be attained later. We haven't attained to it yet. Nobody has, they say. Nobody has. It's very difficult. This is arrogance. This is insane. This is all arrogance. We're suffering from the logic of arrogance, thinking we have to win a non-existent contest. Sometimes I feel like homeless people, they need somebody just to sit near them or be near them, truth conscious, just to reassure them that, you know, you are not bound by any situation or any condition. You can get free. You will get free of all arrogance. You absolutely will. There's a lot of people very much struggling, and this has always been the case in this world. I saw a guy yesterday, a couple of days ago, was begging for money, and, you know, obviously the guy had an alcohol problem. Most of them do. They try to kill the pain of their, that the arrogance is producing so much suffering in us, and they don't realize how to get free of it, so they just try to kill the pain of it. I understand, absolutely. You know, I mean, we're all tempted to do that. Sometimes I just feel like, why don't we just start drinking alcohol and just drown our suffering and misery, just so we can become oblivious to it, you know. It's always that severe temptation. So many people fall prey to that temptation. Alcohol is an extreme problem in this country, probably around the world right now. Extreme problem in many places. Some places prohibit it. They're very wise to do so. Although their frustrations boil up to and act out in various ways, which may not be so good either. You know, here we just, when we're frustrated, people just go and start drinking. If there's no alcohol in a land, maybe people get super frustrated and they start, you know, attacking and getting angry and stuff. So I don't know what the answer is there, but we do abuse alcohol to an extreme extent in this land and in many places. So I saw this man. I said, wow, okay. He's really in trouble. Yeah, no question about it. Once you go down that road, you're in big trouble. And I always hold the thought that they absolutely, they're already free of their affliction. They're already free of it. No doubt in my mind. It's a done deal. It's an absolute done deal. So don't ever hold anyone to any appearance. Okay, don't ever hold anyone to every appearance. They're already free of it. It's a done deal. They're already free of it. This is just a memory that they're entertaining, actually. So you laugh, smile, and say you're having fun with your memories, huh? That's okay. I know you. I see you. I know you're already free of it. There's no question about it. Jesus actually tells us that we're already free of all this. We're only engaged in our memories. We're only, as a dream of our memories, so to speak. Maybe imaginary memories, but look at it that way. You see, whatever you see, they're already free of that appearance. They're already perfect. They're already flawless. And they're just entertaining a sort of a fantasy of memories of the way that it used to be or the way that they thought it might be. But it's not ever that way. It's never been that way. So don't hold anyone to any appearances. Don't hold anyone to any appearances. So don't say to the person, don't pray for them to get well. That doesn't work. Be certain that they're already free of it. And they've never been held bound by any appearance. This is just memories, a play of memories they're doing to honor their creativity. But they're not bound by anything, any appearance whatsoever. They're already free of it, absolutely free of it, and be certain of it. That's how Jesus, you know, helped others. He said, your faith made you whole, but he was absolutely certain that they were already free of their affliction. Absolutely knew it to be a fact. And he knew it so perfectly that people, you know, realized, oh, wow, yeah, this is just a memory. I know that. And then, poof, you know, illness vanished instantly. Look at all the miracles he did. Or was a part of, played a role in all those miracles. You name it, you know, all sorts of afflictions. Including natural afflictions like being a storm on Lake Galilee, being swamped in a boat. And he said, be still. Basically saying it's already still. This is just a memory. This is how it's done. And this is what Christian Science was trying to bring into the world and brought into the world. And for a while, but it got swamped by cosmic corporate culture and it's unfortunately, because that was a tremendous dispensation that took place in this world, Christian Science. And Mary Baker Eddy and those who were involved with that did a tremendous job bringing that to light, that you don't pray for the affliction to leave somebody, or you pray to God, please God, remove this affliction, this terrible affliction. You assert that they're already free of it. In fact, they've always been free of it. It doesn't never really touch them at all. And you just sit there and keep asserting in your own mind the truth of the situation, and that's how healing takes place. And they had a tremendously successful in what Christian Science did. So many healings took place. This is like lost in history, isn't it? I mean, how many people spend time thinking about that? I mean, it's just something that is completely vanished from our consciousness, which is astonishing, because Christian Science was extremely popular and well-known in the last, century and some odd and a half or something, however long it's been. There was a Christian Science reading room in every town in the country, okay? And its demise is just absolutely astonishing. And it came about for a number of factors, and one of them is the pharmaceutical industry. And doctors, the pharmaceutical industry, pushing doctors to, you know, and the laws that they've pushed into, basically, you know, criminalizing Christian Science and spiritual healing. It's been criminalized in this world now. Astonishing, huh? Absolutely astonishing. That's true healing. What they were involved with was true healing. So the healer, the practitioner, is absolutely certain that this affliction is going to vanish. Absolutely certain that it's already been let go of, that it never really had a grip, true grip on you at all. It's a done deal. It's an absolute done deal. It's just an appearance, and no appearance has any grip on you whatsoever. And they know that the truth of you is true right now. The truth of your perfection is true right now. Right now, this is a fact. Now, this was very advanced, wonderful dispensation of truth here in this world. And New Thought also developed that and went with that quite wonderfully. New Thought was quite wonderful in a lot of ways. Arrogance may have hijacked it into this new world religion of the supremacy, the of the the infallibility and the ultimate, the inherent supremacy, the inherent infallibility of women. It sort of got hijacked in that direction, actually. Unfortunately, arrogance saw to that. Arrogance said, hey, if we can really fit this in with a new world, a new millennium, so dispensationalism and millennialism, the Essene belief in making this world a perfect place, all that stuff, they tried to accommodate this, you know, and it ended up spinning off into what we have these days, which is so terrible. And those who refused to do that basically became, lost their clout sort of in the world in a lot of ways. Like Marie Watts, she never played that game. Very, very strong spirit of truth consciousness in Marie Watts, who's a New Thought practitioner, really, and author. She never got into this, you know, nonsense about the supremacy of women that Emma Hopkins got into, and others. She never got into that, and she was tremendous. And very little is known about her, actually. Talk about someone who had transcended the body, never even left a picture of herself at all. I have no idea what she even looked like, her body looked like. But she taught tremendously. Tremendous teacher. But again, she didn't play ball with the spiritual politics of trying to integrate arrogance and truth consciousness, which Jesus talks about in the parable of the sower, meaning some seeds are sown in thorns, thorn bush or thorn areas or something, or the weeds, the thorn bush chokes it out because you're trying to integrate the two and it goes bad eventually. And somehow Christian Science went in that direction too, because when I visited Christian Science reading rooms, it was completely run by feminists, radical feminists, period. And it was the whole thing had been twisted into promoting the supremacy, the natural divine supremacy of women. The entire thing. I said, my God, you know, it's just I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. What had come of it. And this results in trying to combine the two belief systems. You have to exchange the belief systems, not combine them. So that dispensation of Christian Science, you know, ran into this problem. Okay, so now then, of course, in miracles came along, which was even more advanced. And we're trying to get past this problem here. Jesus absolutely, adamantly is pointing out, you know, you cannot combine truth and lies. This is what A Course in Miracles very focused on. You have to exchange belief systems. You cannot integrate them or combine them in any way. And so, obviously, we've run through these dispensations where we keep making progress, and then we run into the next severe problem. And apparently, Christian Science and New Thought ran into this problem, and which is ultimately, you know, has produced this extreme trouble we have in the world now of arrogance. It's puffed them up so much that they're, you know, the new world religion is the belief in the inherent supremacy of women, the infallibility of women, and the inherent divinity of women over men, as superior to men. There's no question about it. That's what's taking place. And this got some of its juice from, you know, the attempt to integrate Christian Science and New Thought with arrogance. Tough business here, isn't it? Very tough. Ridiculously tough, actually. We've really put ourselves in a ridiculous situation. We put ourselves in a ridiculous situation in believing that there's such a thing as situations, you know, so much. There isn't. Situations are impossible. That's why we're just here now. There's no situation for us that needs to be overcome at all. Our consciousness is not entrapped in any situation. It's inherently free. It's free right now. is absolutely free of this for everyone, this very instant. So when you see someone who's sick or infirm, struggling, mental struggles, you realize their consciousness is absolutely free as yours, just as free as Jesus's. There's no difference whatsoever. There's absolutely no difference. Everyone's consciousness is perfectly free. Always has been and always will be. And keep this fact and accept this fact. Keep accepting this fact. There's nothing you need to do to make this so. There's nothing that needs to happen or you need to do to make this so. It's already so. It's already so. It's already so. So now we're going to have a new dispensation of Jesus. I don't know how that's going to go. This should be, I don't know. I don't even want to speculate. We just keep doing the best we can. And Jesus is very good at only giving us as much as we can handle, but not more than we can handle. It's not that he's not transparent. It's just pragmatically, you cannot overload us because of our continuity fears. So we always use the opportunity of a video to go, as far as we can towards realizing the path of no path. To shaking off the shocks and troubles of this world and the dispensations and how they run into trouble and how it gets twisted and ends up feeling arrogance again, We have to keep forgiving, realizing that we're all free right now. Everyone is entirely free right now. There's no one that is bound by any circumstance or situation whatsoever right now. This is a fact right now. We're only having memories of pretending to be bound, but no one is bound. No one is bound by anything. There's no bondage. Spirit is not bound by any appearance. Spirit is not bound by any appearance. There's no reciprocal relationship between spirit and appearance in terms of binding spirit to that appearance whatsoever. There's none. There never has been, never will be. Now, there are all sorts of practices that have been used throughout history. Some people say, see everybody as the deity, See everybody as the deity, as divinity already. Don't even pay attention to what you think they look like, their memories of what they look like. It's just a memory. See, if you realize that everything in this world is just a memory, we don't have to keep remembering what we thought we looked like as bodies when we're actually spirit. We don't have to. Maybe we can just drop that. So don't hold anybody to what their memories. Because the memories of a dream is what it is. A dream of memories. It's a dream of memories that we're having, actually. Dream of memories we're having. What's today? Ascension Day. In the Catholic calendar, it's Ascension Day. Jesus ascended from the Mount of Olives. Up in the clouds and said, and the angels appeared and said, he shall return the same way that he left. They didn't necessarily say he's going to return to the exact same spot. Many think that that's what's going to happen. That he has to return to the Mount of Olives. I don't know where they get that exactly. I don't know if that's supported by scripture really. So what I hear them saying is, we'll just float back into this world the way he floated up and disappeared from their view in the sky. He'll just sort of float down and appear in the world from the sky. That's basically what they were saying. And it could have been spiritual ideas that he's just going to, he'll just appear, you know, in this world, like out of seeming out of nowhere, not through a birth, not through a birth. Okay, made it very clear what they're saying. He's not, his return is not going to be one of taking birth in this world. He'll return the same way he left. He'll come from the sky, you know, fully formed, so to speak, fully here, not as a baby. He will not be born as a child, a baby, etc. That's not how Jesus is going to return. He'll return as a spirit, essentially. Perhaps there'll be a vague, you know, form, imaginary form, so that we can feel comfortable relating to this vague form. That's how I experienced Jesus, is he had this vague form there, but I couldn't really determine any determinate features, so to speak, really. Sort of like, you know, a form that's vectorized, you know, through a vectorization, and, you know, all the sharp features and stuff, details all kind of smoothed out, like in a vectorization, sort of like that. But you realize who it is, you know. So, yeah. You know, and we don't have to, people running around saying they're Jesus, they don't have to say, just say I'm the spirit of truth too. Jesus said we would be like him. Okay, so we can say, well, I'm like Jesus. I'm one with Jesus. I'm the spirit of truth like Jesus. Well, we don't have to say, you know, specifically that we are the return of Jesus. We're the one that everyone's been waiting for. You know, that is not necessary to say that kind of stuff. You know, just, If you've got the spirit of truth within you, then say it. But you don't have to say that you are the historical Jesus. I mean, why? It's not necessary. let that one deal with being that one, so to speak. There's a lot of responsibility with that. Let that aspect of oneness, you know, be that aspect of oneness and take care of its responsibilities. In terms of, you know, pragmatic responsibilities of helping us out. So we can say, yeah, I'm the spirit of truth, absolutely. I am Christ. I am the Son of God, meaning we're all the sons of God. We're all Christ. We're all one spirit. So I am the spirit of truth. We're all the spirit of truth right now. It's unavoidable. And the fact that we appear otherwise is nothing but our sheer arrogance and memories of the believed in causality of this arrogance. Where else can causality have believe that it's non? Where else can the non-causality of arrogance believe that it can have causality except in an imagined memories of an imagined past? It's just memories of an imagined past that never really took place. But we have a very strong imagination, don't we? We can cook up all of this. It's quite amazing. The power of the creativity of mind is quite astonishing. How are we doing? Okay, well, it's getting a little late now. I do have to get up in the morning and try to go to work. And so, in your life, just keep powering through the path of no path. Just keep every day going as fast as you can. That's all you can do. Don't worry about ultimate results. They'll take care of themselves. It's like in golf. Just keep hitting good shots. Don't worry about your score. You'll add it up at the end anyway, right? And if you just concentrate on one shot at a time, hitting great shots, and stay in the now, and just keep working as hard as you can, yeah, and then let the score be what the score is going to be. Don't be thinking about keeping score. Don't keep score. You'll play a lot better if you don't keep score. I mean, don't put it in your mind. Like, okay, what's my score now after three holes? As soon as you do that, your game's going to go to pieces. There's no question about it. You just have to forget about the, you know, write your score down, but forget about what you've done. Someone asks you, what are you doing shooting? You say, I don't know. I'm not even paying attention to it. All the best golfers are that way, almost all of them. They don't even know. They don't even look at the scoreboard. They don't even pay attention. They're just concentrating and says, how do I execute this next shot? That's all they're thinking about. So that they really live in the now. It's a discipline. It's a very strong discipline. And when you're not living in the now, it shows. Your game starts falling apart. That's why it's very difficult for golfers to finish a golf tournament and win, because they start thinking about winning. That's why so often they fall apart on the final holes and somebody else wins. It's extremely difficult to finish out, because they start thinking, hey, I'm winning. I'm ahead by two. All I got to do is do this and I'm going to be a winner. And then before you know it, disaster strikes. It's amazing. It's amazing what happens. It's very rare the ones that can just finish it out very strongly, because they're not even thinking about it. So we need to be like that. We need to be good closers and not fall apart at the end. So we just keep working as hard as we can. And let the results take care of themselves. What else can we do? So again, Jesus is back. Church age is ended. The papacy is ended. We now have the opportunity to relate directly with Jesus in a stronger way than ever before, in a more direct way than ever before. And so this is the truth moving forward. And you can, you know, sometimes I'm not critical, but sometimes I pointed out things about teachers who say, well, if you come see me, you can be enlightened, you know. But you can get your life can turn around. I'm not saying you can be enlightened. No, that means to just drop all your arrogance. I think that's pretty arrogant to say that people, all they have to do is come see me and they're going to be enlightened. But they can, in their heart, in their mind, they can realize, you know what? You know, I can be enlightened. Or I know I'm already enlightened. This is all just a memory. And yet the continuity fear may take them quite some time to accept this totally. So there is something, if you go see someone, the truth of spirit of truth is there. Truth consciousness is there. You will be affected possibly by that. You will get this sense that of spiritual confidence. That doesn't mean, though, that in 5 days' time you're going to be enlightened. That doesn't mean that at all. These memories really have a hold on us. And the continuity fear has a hold on us. And our arrogance has a hold on us. So, you know, you just say, realize, hey, you know, you might even say, well, yeah, I'm enlightened. But you have to see that everybody is. Everybody is. You can't be enlightened unless you see everyone's enlightened. It's not possible. You cannot be enlightened by yourself. It's completely impossible. You have to realize everyone is enlightened. Everyone is free right now. No one is bound. There's no bondage whatsoever anywhere. That's enlightenment, and nothing else is enlightenment. So people might get this contact high and think, wow, I think I can get enlightened eventually. But that's not really enlightenment. Enlightenment is the realization right here, right now, that everyone is enlightened exactly as, no matter what appearances may suggest otherwise. Those appearances are just ancient memories that have no bearing on the truth of now whatsoever. Ancient imaginary memories, actually. Everyone is enlightened right now, without any exception. Even that man that sat in church behind me that looked like a chupacabra or something, you know. You know, he was like a human chupacabra. It's like, I cannot place his I could not draw what it looks like. What he looked like. He's absolutely enlightened now too. This appearance is only a memory, an imaginary memory of an imaginary past. So there's no such thing as my enlightenment. There's only everyone's enlightenment. No one is in bondage in any way whatsoever. It's impossible. No one is in bondage. Everyone is free right this moment and every moment. So again, keep on looking at this, looking at this. This is truth consciousness. This is truth consciousness. This is what Jesus is bringing. This is the truth consciousness that Jesus brings. This is the truth consciousness that we can be the same, have exact same truth consciousness as Jesus. In fact, we have to. We have to. So while the Pope is preaching, whereas the no longer the Pope is preaching, you know, okay, you know, that our mission in the world is to feed the poor. That's what our mission is. Well, this isn't really quite being the shepherd of truth consciousness that the Pope is supposed to be. But our mission is to realize that everybody is enlightened. And the real saints and sages tell us that this is, do just this, and this is the greatest good you can do for the world. There's nothing else comes close. This is what Ramana Maharshi said. You know, enlightenment, the realization that all is enlightened right now, is the greatest good you can do for the world without any question about it. So that is what we really need to do. And when we do that, all this poverty that in the world, you know, we'll realize, hey, we're not, those are just ancient imaginary memories. We're not stuck on that. We don't have to be stuck on that. We don't have all this suffering. We don't have to be stuck on any of that. This is what really liberates the world. Now you can give them some food too. Why not? Sure, we don't want people starving, but your truth consciousness must be first and foremost that everyone is enlightened right now. That there are no circumstances arising for any aspect of spirit whatsoever. There are no situations arising for any aspect of spirit. Spirit is absolutely immaculately, perfectly free this very instant, without a single exception, without a single exception. This is true. Let's see. There you go. Jesus is looking serious there, you know, intense, serious, composed. He's saying, no exception, without any, there's no exception. This is the dispensation of A Course in Miracles. It's so beautiful, wonderful. It is reassuring us there is no exception. Do not make a single exception. And again and again and again, Jesus drills this into us. And we have to keep drilling this into us until we finally accept that this is true. There is not a single exception. Never has been any exception. Never has been any exception. There's never been any situation arise for anyone, including birth, including death, and including body existence. None of that has ever arisen as a circumstance or situation for any of us. It's just an imaginary memory. It's an appearance. All appearances are equally appearances. They're completely, equally non-binding to spirit. So no situations or circumstances have ever arisen for anyone. This is truth consciousness. This is truth consciousness. So, if you relating to Jesus, you'll find out that this is what Jesus will convey to you. Will convey to you, and just say, there's no exception. Wow. But if you can say, great, that's what I want to hear. Thank you very much. That's wonderful. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Then you know you're getting it. It's sinking into you. Absolutely. And yet you're full stop in the wow. You're not one of those who get all giddy and excited, and the ones that the seeds that fall on thin ground, shallow ground, and just rocks right underneath it. So while they're like, wow, you know, like the plant grows really fast and suddenly just withers because it has no roots. You know, you just say, okay, it's wonderful. The full stop in the wow. Let me just let this sink in. Let me digest this. This is, you know, I want to hear some more. This is what I really want. This is the food, the bread of life that you came to bring us. This is the bread of life that gives us eternal life. That reminds us that we are eternal life. That reminds us that all is eternal life, actually. And we just have to let this sink in. He says, gradually, Jesus says, it sinks in, seeps in. Gradually it sinks in, Until he says there always will come one moment where just it clicks and just, yeah, I see it. I accept it now. Yeah, he says that will happen to everyone. So, you know, so when it happens, it happens. Just meanwhile, keep working on it intensely as possible. Okay, so wonderful. Let's stop it right here so I can get to bed before midnight. Okay, very great. That's it.